next workshop on politics and society is going to be introduced by Yasemin Acar from Claremont Graduate University and Ozyegin University. Yasemin finished her bachelor's from Colorado University in Boulder in 2007 in psychology. Then she had her master's in general psychology from New York State University in 2009.
New York
University.
Sorry,
NYU.
Yeah.
And she's currently doing her PhD in applied psychology at Claremont Graduate University in Los Angeles. She is specialized in social psychology in general, and she is today going to introduce us or told us about her book, Becoming Us Without Becoming One, which is on perspectives on Gezi. So, welcome.
Thank you. For the flawed introduction. I know a good chunk of you already, but for those of you who don't know, like Adi said, I'm a Claremont Graduate University. I'm almost finished with my PhD there. But I'm also a teacher here. I've been here, this is my third year now. And I work in the psychology department, teaching social psychology, political psychology, self and identity, and group relations, as well as a general psychology course for those outside of the department. And like he mentioned, this is data based on a book that just came out in October with a friend of mine, a colleague in Jakobs University Bremen, Ozyegin. So she sends her greetings. She couldn't be here, of course, but in her place, I'll try to do my best. What am I going to talk to you about? Let me just kind of, and I realized that like the screen is kind of doing this really irritating thing, so I know that I just gave your focus to it, but try not to pay attention to that. So I'm going to talk to you about participants in the Gezi Park protests, particularly people who were politically active beforehand as well. So we're going to talk about a little bit more in general who the protesters were going into Gezi Park, who they became, and the connection to the quote-unquote culture identity. I'm going to introduce to you a social identity perspective within the social psychology discipline to understanding group relations in Gezi Park. I'll discuss with you very briefly the methodology and who our participants were, and then I'll show you our results. So to start off with, who were the protesters going into the park? Well, Konda did a really great poll during the Gezi occupation, and they polled over 1,000 people. They made this fantastic grid of the park, and most of the people they spoke to said that they participated in the protests as a citizen. That is, they did not feel that they were representing any particular group or organization coming into the park. That does not mean they did not have any group memberships, but that in their initial contact with the protesters and their initial contact with the protest itself, they participated as sade vatandaş, so just as a simple citizen. Also, quite interestingly, about half of them had never participated in a protest before. This is a really high number for protests. Generally, protests spawn protests from protests, so people who participate are generally activists. So to see a number that high is quite interesting. But the focus more for us is something like this. The people who had absolutely no membership in any group or civil society was 79%. The focus for our particular research is this other 21% here, who are also some sort of member of a group. So this is who people were as they came into the park protests. What we saw come about is a new kind of identity. Now, you all already know this, I'm sure, but this idea of the Çapulcu identity came about when, on June 2nd, the Prime Minister referred to the protesters as 3 or 5 looters. In doing so, it really allowed participants to have something to hold on to identify themselves and to express themselves. And it could be argued that this kind of came out as a subordinate identity, which we're going to go into a little bit more. Of course, you started seeing this Çapulcu thing everywhere. If you're on Facebook, which you are, of course you're on Facebook. everybody started to kind of change their names, right, to Chapulju, Ayash, Bilmemne, Bilmemne. And so we saw these kinds of different things coming out. And Chapulju, I remember I was also conducting research in the park at the time. And I went up to one of the stands, and there was a woman there, and she said to me, and her phrase was, you know, I asked her if she would help me with my research, and she said, yani bir çapulcu olarak yardım etmeye her zaman hazırım. Now think about what that means, right? As a çapulcu, as a looter, I'm always ready to help. Okay? If you take the meaning that is normally given to that word, it doesn't make any sense. Okay? But with the labeling by the Prime Minister onto people who already started to view themselves as in-group, this came to have a whole new meaning, and to say, I'm a person who helps other people, therefore I'm a çapulcu, became quite normal. So how does the social identity perspective fit here? Social identity can be defined as a part of the self-concept that derives from our membership in social groups. So a social group can be, you know, members of a university, so Ozyegin students, it could be a teacher, it could be your gender, class, social class, your race, your political party, your nationality, your language group, your family group. These are all different kinds of social identities that you have. Through our social identities, it helps us to understand who we are and our place in the world, and how we understand our relationships with other people. And how does that work in a group context? Well, if I'm a çapulcu and she's a çapulcu and he's a çapulcu and they're not çapulcu, then there's a distinction that's created there. It helps us understand our values and their values. Okay. Identity is also really useful in creating a positive sense of self. So especially when it's something that we give a lot of meaning or value to, it becomes a source of self-esteem for us. What I want to talk about particularly is identity that occurs at different levels. There are, like we said, families, gender, social class, nationality, language groups, university students, and the size of these groups differ. An Ozyegin student is not just a, you know, university student at Ozyegin, they can also fit into the larger category of university students in general. Likewise, I'm from New York, okay, and that fits into another category, which is American. So in this case, you have a subordinate identity of New Yorker and a superordinate identity of America. And depending on the situation, I can refer to myself as a New Yorker or as an American. So in a case where, say, there is a non-American in the room, if I am with a friend who's from California, that person is now in-group, okay? Because the level of understanding has changed. We're not looking at where we're from specifically anymore. I'm from New York, he's from California. You're looking now at the fact that you are from Turkey and I'm from New York and from California, and that fits into American. Okay. So now we're looking at the level of American versus non-American. How does that work for the protests? Well, if we think about it like this, you had a number of different groups there who saw each other as, you know, based on these category memberships, and somehow they became part of the same group, okay, labeled under the çapulcu identity, or gezici, or occupier, or resistor. And one of the images that we saw coming out of Gezi that really represented this for us was AKM. Okay, so if you think about the mosaic that is AKM at that time, there are a number of different categories represented, a number of different parties and organizations, all in the same place, okay? So there's your subordinate representations in a superordinate context, okay, like this. Generally, you cannot just have one overarching identity, you also need some sort of comparison group. So I said, I'm a New Yorker, he's a Californian, but we're American because you're here and you're Turkish. Similarly, the way for these groups to become one is to have an outgroup, okay? A very visible outgroup. Say in the police, who are uniformed, who are actively working against you, who are creating conflict. And when you have a group like that, it becomes very clear who's out-group and who's in-group. Of course, we had some really interesting times with the Bali Twitter, but it didn't really work out for him very well. I also want to mention a model of collective action by Van Zomer and Postmas and Spears, who basically say that there are three main antecedents to participation in collective action. These include your identity, which we've already discussed, a perception of injustice, okay, that something has been done to wrong you. Generally, this is based on an identity, okay, so something to wrong you as a woman or something to wrong you as a socialist, okay, as well as a sense of efficacy, the feeling that if you protest, you will be able to bring about some kind of change. The feeling that you can do this. Okay? Identity is generally enough to create collective action, but the three pieces together are considered the most important antecedents to collective action participation. So, what did we do in this study? We talked to 34 participants, 34 individuals, with 31 interviews. That means in the first three interviews, we had two people at the same time. Each one was, we spoke with each one as a representative of his or her group. That is not to say, and I'm going to go into this as we see the list of participants, that is not to say that a person only has one group membership, okay, but that we spoke to them based on that particular category. So I'll explain what I mean in a moment. We asked them their reasons for participation as an individual and as a group member, their perceptions of injustice in that situation, their identification, their relationship with other groups, and the support of the category, okay? And whether or not they felt that they had made some sort of difference, okay? So more specifically, the questions here based on identity are about the relationships between your particular in-group, say, if you're a member of Halkevide, okay? And your subordinate category of Gezici or Çapulcu. The importance of being in Halkevide, okay, how you feel about that particular group, and your personal reasons for attending the protest. So we first asked about their experiences with bad and interesting, so that we could kind of warm up the conversation. Did they attend alone or with some particular organization? How important, did I mention that already? So in the wrong place, how important is that identity? Why did your group attend? So not just why you went as an individual, but why do you feel that the Communist Party of Turkey was there? Okay. And the groups that you felt close to and similar to or kind of distant from, and this part is a little bit more like dedikodu, kind of like gossiping, like, come on. They were there, but did you really like them? You know? But it was kind of my favorite part also to hear. So these were our participants. Okay, so we broke them into some larger categories. Alevi activists, anti-capitalists and revolutionary Muslims, Çarşı, women's rights activists, Kemalists, Kurdish activists, LGBTI activists, trade unions. Our trade unions were SES, the Sağlık ve Sosyal Hizmet Emekçileri, and TMO, different socialist parties and Hürkücü. And I want to remind you again, we asked them based on a particular social category rather than all of their social identities. So if I say somebody's a Kurdish activist, that doesn't mean that they are not also a socialist or also an Alevi. Okay? It just means that for our particular interview, they participated based on their representation as a member of BDP. And we spoke to them based on their membership as a BDP party member, rather than talking to them as a socialist or as an Alevi or something else. If you have questions about that later, we can go into it. But so you can see the parts where we had two participants in one particular situation. So again, we asked them about their reasons for participating. Across groups, I'm going to show you the reasons that everybody basically stated together, the differences within the groups, and how each group sees each other. This is a little bit long, so I'm gonna try to go rather quickly through this particular part. If you have questions afterwards, I wanna leave at least 20 to 30 minutes for discussion and questions, so that we can look again more specifically if you like. Across groups, these are the things that every group said. Okay, first of all, there was some sort of like an eruption of emotion that occurred, and that it was like the last straw, you know, the last drop in the glass, and this is why people participated. Everyone mentioned the importance of protecting the green space, but there was a long list of complaints about AKP. Okay? So AKP was the main reason why most people were there. Okay? There was a dissatisfaction with it in general. They saw excessive police force and decided they needed to protest. There was a very palpable concern about the future of the country because of the position of AKP. Okay? And the tavır of the prime minister, the way that the prime minister approached people. A lot of people mentioned that he's from Kasımpaşa, so he behaves like he's from Kasımpaşa kind of thing. 4+4+4, the new education system was also mentioned. And bear in mind that leading up to the protests, especially in the previous 2 months, there were a series of events that occurred that had started to bother people. So you may remember that May 1st, May Day, was banned, and there was all sorts of attempts to prevent people from going to Taksim. Reyhanlı had just happened a couple of weeks before that. Internet censorship and women's rights issues had just come up before that. Alcohol prohibition was being mentioned. All sorts of things were going on in that time. And so it was kind of the last straw related to those events as well. So I want to start with the Alevi activists. One was, we spoke with one from Tuzluçayır and one from Hatay. So they mentioned fears of assimilation. They mentioned specifically there was a power plant issue I don't remember where it's in Hatay, maybe. If I'm wrong, you remind me. The participant from Hatay more specifically mentioned the issues with AKP policy towards Syria at the time had made them very nervous. They had started to connect the police presence in their neighborhoods as one kind of representing al-Nusra. They felt that the police were connected to al-Nusra. They were worried about the way that AKP was dealing with the Syrian situation would affect them first. And so when the protests occurred in Hatay, they were very, very different, say, from in Ankara or Istanbul, because you had a huge amount of, he mentioned that people were throwing like their refrigerators, washing machines, anything they could out of their windows to create barricades because they felt it was like the last stand. So the imminent threat feeling was much different than in, say, Istanbul or Ankara, as it was in Hatay. The anti-capitalist and revolutionary Muslims, bear in mind, these are two different groups. We spoke to a member from each group, spoke specifically about economic issues, but also stated that part of the reason they wanted to be there in the protest was to make sure that the image of Muslims as being, all supporters of AKP. They wanted to show their solidarity with the importance of this movement. Çarşı, I did all of the Çarşı interviews, which was a lot of fun for me. They mentioned, all three of them mentioned specifically the Beşiktaş Gençler Birliği match, which I think was on the 11th of May. And this was the last match, in the Inönü Stadium before it was demolished. And more, I think it has a capacity of around 30,000 and over 100,000 people. Stadium. There were locks on the gates so that people couldn't get in, and they broke the locks, and everybody kind of stormed the stadium, and the police started throwing tear gas, so it was a very kind of strong reaction. Someone even wrote an op-ed piece about, Gezi is Çarşı's revenge for the, Beşiktaş Gençler really much, which is a little bit overblown, but that was the impression. They talked about being from Beşiktaş, so the neighborhood itself being so close to Taksim, they felt it was necessary for them to be there to kind of show their position as mahalle çocukları, so to speak, to kind of represent and support Taksim in that way. Women spoke specifically about the issues that had been coming up, like I mentioned before, in the months coming up to Gezi, concerns about abortion rights, concerns about morning after pill, the way that the state and members of the state spoke about women. Okay, so this phrase is not the only one that we heard. A woman who gets pregnant from rape should give birth, the state will take care of the child. There were also statements like, if a woman gets raped, she should be killed, not the child, things like this, which of course are really awful and really influenced women, because we know that the visibility of women at Gezi was very high for their participation. I really like this quote a lot. Some went to prevent their heads from being covered. Some went to say they no longer wanted their veil to be used as a political tool. So this was another perspective that was brought out there. Kemalist spoke very specifically about the values of being an Ataturkist in general. They were concerned what they called the prohibition of national holidays. So you may have noticed, especially in the past few years, that there's always something terrible that happens around the time of a national holiday, so it's always kind of like, we're not going to celebrate it. Erginekon was a big issue. A couple of years ago, the swipe out of the military heads was a big concern. You also probably saw on Facebook that people started putting Tece on their names as a response to Tece being taken off from some of the buildings. So these were all of the issues that were mentioned. That's clear, right? Okay. Kurdish activists were less specific about issues related to the Kurdish movement and more concerned about, or more there because of Sırrısıraya. So Sırrısıraya was always mentioned. Since Sırrısıraya was there from the beginning, we also went, basically. Also more specific to them was a mention of the way the violence of the police conflict reminded them of the 90s, and they felt a need to be there as well. So and again, of course, the issues during May, the issues around talks with MX cinemas, with Birmayis, etc., etc. Members of the LGBT community, the LGBTI community, basically said, we've always been against the government, we've always been against the state, and so it makes sense for us to be there. We had a participant who identifies herself as a trans woman, and she said, as a trans woman, I have more safety concerns, I have more issues to deal with, and that's why I, in particular, had to be there. With the trade unionists, we mostly heard about the issues you probably already know between AKP and Timok. Okay, so Timok, whenever they kind of pointed out that there was an issue with an urban renewal project, got some sort of restriction put on them somehow. And at this point, by the time that Gezi started, Timok was already kind of ready for an upheaval. The socialist parties, in general, said very similar things, but slightly different from each one, of course. You know, SFA will focus on Ezilenler, okay? Emek talked more specifically about Mayday. SFP talked more specifically about urban renewal, but also mentioned Birmayis, Altamayis, and Onsekizmayis. So Birmayis with Mayday, Altamayis that was the, commemoration of Deniz Gezmiş, etc. And then the 18th of May was the start of the Turkish Airlines strikes. Actually, Çarşı also mentioned this. Çarşı mentioned that they were heading to the Turkish Airlines strike at the time that they heard that they needed to go to Gezi. So they kind of changed their plan and went there as well. SYKP again mentioned all of those things as well, but TKP went a little bit further as usual. And especially this position here was really brought up. Halk kendi kendine sokağa dökülmüştür, bunun korunması TKP'nin görevi. So TKP members saw themselves with a very, very important mission to protect the people who have just poured into the streets. last but not least, Ürkücü. Now we had some really interesting talks with the members that İstanbul İl Başkan Yardımcısı former. He was encouraged to leave the party after Gezi, as was the member from Ankara. Okay, so they participated in Gezi protests. They wrote articles about the Gezi protests. They encouraged dialogue between the left and the right. And as a result, they were asked very nicely to leave Mehmet. So we cannot talk to how representative they are of Mehmet, but I thought it was really important to include them, of course. They had specific issues with the prime minister. His behavior is a tendency to see issues as either black or white and not in between. They felt that there was a persecution against them, especially in the public sector when they were looking for work. They felt that rather than choosing people from different backgrounds, you were more likely to see members of AKP or people close to AKP would be hired. So they felt that as MHP, they were, as members of MHP, they were not able to get work. Of course, the Oslo meetings were an issue for them, and concerns about the future of Turkey, so they felt, oh, you're going towards, you know, are you going to be like Iran? This was mentioned by both participants. In a very general sense, okay, the groups that were seen as most close were the LGBTI movement, the anti-capitalist Muslims, and Çarşı. The most distant or the most criticized were İşçi Partisi and TGB. And in between was the Kurdish National Movement. Now, some people said they didn't want the Kurdish movement there. Okay? And some people said they wished that the Kurdish movement had a stronger presence there. Okay? So when I say in between, it was some ambiguous responses based on these issues. This is more specific, okay, so who each group felt close to or distant from. Again, so we can go through this more specifically when we go into the questions. I just want to let you know that it's all there. Okay. So what did we see in terms of reasons for participation? Well, a lot of different reasons. Okay, there are a lot of different reasons. But you also may have noticed that the overlap was really, really high. Okay? From the language of the participants, we saw that there was an understanding of the subordinate group. Okay? So the discussion of we or all of us was brought up a lot. There was some critique of different participants. There was some sense of closeness, of course, between different groups, ambivalence, of course. But in general, there was a sense of bringing people together in the name of the Gezi spirit. So this is what we ended up seeing. We conducted these interviews over 10 months. Starting last year in October. And of course, one of the limitations that I can mention is the fact that over the course of 10 months, a lot of different things happened. You already know this. We had all the tape in December last year. We had the issues with Soma. We had the issues over the summer with the other construction strikes, etc. Berkin Bond's funeral happened. So a number of issues came up over that time, which can influence the way that people remember their participation. Also, just the fact that months and months have passed, and in retrospect, when you look back on your participation, it's likely to be impacted as well. So I just want to finish it up there and leave it open for communication, because that's what I'm more used to. So this is just my presentation. Of course, if you have any questions, comments, we can go back and look at the slides and discuss it. So thank you for that. Thank you for giving me your time.
Should we turn the light?
We turn on the light. Well, it turned off on its own. I don't know.
You can't.
There we go.
Okay.
Let there be light.
I'll start.
Please.
I mean, obviously, I find this very interesting.
course, I mean, used that in the interview too.
Yeah.
So I was wondering whether that became an issue, or you guys talked about this, how it actually affects your kind of findings.
Mm-hmm.
And relatedly, again, the other thing is that I'm a little afraid that kind of looking at, you know, this issue coming from this activist identity, and then talking about Çapulcu identity as the, you know, the emerging identity, I'm wondering whether, like, I mean, obviously we have all seen the Çapulcu identity emerging,
yeah.
So I'm not questioning that. But is there any other identity that is emerging that maybe, you know, we are not talking about because we already buy the Çapulcu identity as something that emerged from it? And specifically, I'm thinking about maybe this right to the city issue, like the being someone from Istanbul issue as some important issues.
Mm-hmm.
And I have one last thing to, and can you also like talk about why you specifically talked about people who were political before? And whether you also did something with the ones that were not political before too?
Yeah, thank you. Remind me very quickly, the first question was about the issue of context and identity. So this was definitely, when we asked the questions about your participation, we would ask the participant, did you attend with X identity? And sometimes they said yes, and sometimes they said no. Absolutely, asking about identity in that way is already reinforcing something that we want to hear. So is this a pure representation of that person's participation? No, I don't think so. Because say, for example, one of our Çarşı members, he's also a member of TKP, and he's Kurdish. Okay? And what he told me was he had a huge conflict in participating, because he said, on that day, TKP was on İstiklal Caddesi, and Çarşı was coming from Harbiye, and I didn't know where to go. So he said, I didn't know if I needed to be with TKP or if I needed to be with Çarşı that day. He said, I chose Harbiye. I chose Harbiye because it was actually easier for me to get there, but my mind was always with TKP. And so his kind of frustration in that kind of situation really kind of shows us that there's no way to just be there as Çarşı. That's not it. You know, that's not the case. So yes, is there a reinforcement of an identity? Yeah, we ask for a specific story here, okay? So also, for example, one of the Kurdish activists, he talked about three identities. He says, Kurdum, Türkiye'liyim, ve sosyalistim. So he talked about being a socialist, talked about being from Turkey, and talked about being a Kurd. We, of course, include all of these, but I wanted to hear if there was some reason as a Kurd that he participated. So yes, this is an issue, absolutely. Can we say that this is really clean? Probably not. But in terms of my analysis, I don't necessarily think it takes away from the reasons for participating, but rather puts a particular light on those reasons for participating. Then there was an issue about emerging identities. So yeah, there's absolutely. So Minis, who was my partner in writing the book, was participating in Ankara at the time that I was participating in Istanbul in the protests. And even that creates a difference. So Ankara'nın işte, there's that feeling of, you know, being in the protests in Ankara. And of course, always we hear is, it was worse in Ankara. And you go, why were you protesting in Ankara? Istanbul is the heart of this whole, and Mevzunun başı burası, you know, this idea. So of course there's another issue that comes out here, there's an identification issue that comes out here. Beyond Çapulcu, I've also questioned like this Gezi Ruhu as a separate identity. Are there other emerging contexts? Absolutely, I'm sure there are, but beyond this, I don't know if any of them are as all-encompassing as, say, Çapulcu, which includes, you know, Ankara, Istanbul, everywhere, right? Even people abroad were calling themselves Çapulcu, who had never, you know, been in something. They, you know, went outside. Turkish flag t-shirt and said, I'm Çokulcu, you know, like, where does that identity come from, you know, if you have not actively participated here? It's quite all-encompassing. But also, I have to mention, especially for the Ülkücü from Istanbul, he said, part of the reason I was there is because I live in Cihangir and I'm Mahalle Çocuğuyum. He said, I'm from here, this is where I have to go. So there's another identity that emerges in that case. Was there one more in the end?
Like, why interviewed the ones who were political before?
I wanted to see about the sub versus subordinate group issue. So when you look at people who are not part of any political organization going into the park, they don't really have that dynamic, right? So there's an existing dynamic between these organizations. Like, you would not find TGB, MHP, BDP, okay, and TKP all in the same place, usually. But we did. So there's an extra element. What's going on there? Yeah. Yeah?
This is a question. I couldn't get the main point exactly about it, because that's why I'm asking. Do you argue that Gezi created this Çokulcu identity, the protesting itself? Did the protest itself create this Çokulcu identity, or it is related to Deniz's question? Was it something that was already happening and somehow protesting together due to different reasons crystallized that identity as it is, or made it more of a like emerging identity? So protest itself, does it have a causal power? Does the protest think itself together at the cause of power in your story? That's the first question. The second question is very much related to this, is like, if that there is a kind of like that emerging identity, kind of like I feel like we have to see a little bit more of a contextual story of the political institutions, how political institutions are like monopolized, or like how they created certain outsiders. Because MHP and BDP were outsiders.
Yeah.
So is TKP and all JHP, trade unions, etc. Like, it creates outsiders of the same political set of institutions that is controlled by AKP. So like, that story might be the reasons why we are seeing an emerging identity to begin with.
Mm-hmm.
So not the protest itself, but the political institutional setup. Or
right.
A macro-social study that might be more looking at capacity. Formation, changing economic structure, etc. But I kind of feel like I would need a little bit more of a convincing if your argument is indeed the protest itself is the main culprit of the emerging identity. Because I would say that there is much more of an effect, I would think. Gezi is just an instantiation of this political institutional exclusion. That's what, you know, from my perspective, it feels like that. And it doesn't conflict with your story either, by the way, what I'm saying, I think.
Right.
Yeah.
So I want to come back to this slide I mentioned also, that in the social identity and social psychology literature, collective action is really heavily influenced by context.
Yeah.
So the main context that's discussed in the collective action literature is the presence and relationship with the police as representatives of the state or as representatives of a larger outfit. So oftentimes a collective action will not result in a subordinate identity, even if you all are part of a protest, because there's no existing outgroup to compare yourself. Most of the time what we see is with collective action and with police conflict, you can start seeing yourself as a singular, like, as a more singular whole. Is it the only way that a new identity forms? No. I mean, if we think about it, prior to June 2nd, prior to the statement by Erdogan about, you know, Çokulcu, people had already come together in some way. And when the
They were already anti-occupy.
This is the issue.
Yeah.
So is being anti-occupy enough to create a new identity? Not, I mean, I don't think so.
Yeah.
It's especially when you have groups so far on the spectrum like Mehmet, holding them together, being anti-AKP is not enough to hold them together. So you need an something else, and that's a conflict with the police that brings you together. But he also called the protesters terrorists. He also called them, you know, other things. But for whatever reason, Çakılcı was the one that was captured. Go ahead.
Thank you. I'm a freshman law student.
Great.
And from my point of view, I can clearly say that today in Turkey, the legislative formations are mostly opposed to secularism. Mm-hmm. And in my point of view, I can. I want to state something to that President Erdogan today states that separation of powers and the constitutional court is a barrier for their ideology, and people, all the group that you mentioned, are trying to highlight their. How can I say? Trying to highlight their. Kendilerini ortaya koyuyorlar. But we face, as I can say, that we face a disaster that destroys all the principles of equity and outlaws the trade unions, and it's also opposed to trade unionists. So that what would you, how can you say, what would you say about what would be in the future if government resists to build that mall in the very place of Gezi Park? What would people react on that?
In my opinion?
Yes.
Wow.
I mean, you have interviewed all the people and you were actually there physically, so what's your opinion about if government resists?
Well, I think the important piece that comes back is also this number here. So this 21% that we're talking about as member of some organization are generally activists anyway. So if there's some attempt to build something there again, I wouldn't doubt that they would go back. The question is whether these 79% would do. Okay. And I think what we have seen was a spike, especially the months following Gezi, a spike in protest participation, and then I think it started to go down again, especially after Soma, especially after there was an, I mean, for me that was a big one too, just personally. There was this decrease in participation, partially because I think that feeling of being effective was gone. Because when you started to protest at Soma, or because of Soma, or because of something else, very quickly the police come, very quickly the police get rid of everybody, and nothing changes. Okay. Now what we saw with Gezi, and when I asked people, did you feel effective, did you feel like something changed? They said, well, two things. One, the park is still a park, so that initial goal is still there. And two, people are more aware of what's going on. So everybody said, yes, we are effective, and everybody said, we kept the park, and we created something in people's mindsets. But that was the only time that we saw that. Now it's been a year and a half. People don't really, in my opinion, that feeling of efficacy is not really there anymore in the protest that we see now. It's again falling back on the people who have who were either politicized before or who became politicized during Gezi. There's not the same response. So I'm afraid that if you ask me, Gezi, if it were to change, it would change. Okay? Yeah?
I have a question talking about the labeling. So as you pointed out, Erdogan used a number of labels, and the Gezi protesters decided to use a specific label. I was wondering if this label has any resonance, let's say, in folklore or something, like cuts up, you know, Chubusha, like, you know, cleftists, or, you know, in Greece, like, you know, it can be used for thug, but it can also be used for resistance fighter and so on. You know, if there is maybe something more to that label that led people to grab it, of all the possible labels that they could have grabbed from the ones used by the government against them.
I wonder if it's, in my mindset, and I would like to hear what other people think about this too, in my mindset it's less that that label had a particular meaning and more that it didn't hold some meaning, like say terrorist,
oh,
is really pretty harsh, and nobody's going to say this terrorist is, you know, we're all terrorists. It's going to be really hard to get that kind of thing, especially from the more nationalist sections.
Mm-hmm.
Nobody's going to want to say that. I think it's the ability of that term to carry new meaning rather than that it has some special meaning beforehand. But I mean, yeah.
Also, I think it was funny because in a way, most of those people who were there were with, you know, like, they were certainly not Chapulcu.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that was such a stupid labeling,
yep.
Because all of them were, you know, most of them were well-educated, most of them were aware of many things. I mean, like, they were like the people, I think, that you could call the least of the group in Turkey as a Çapulcu. Probably that was...
From class and education.
From class and education.
So middle class, essentially.
Yeah. I don't want to call it a middle class movement because it has been called that a lot.
No.
Yeah.
We didn't talk to them because the purpose was to see the subgroup relationships, like the relationships between existing parties, between existing activists. But I think the feeling that most people expressed of being close to Çarşı, Legebete, who else did I say?
The least political
ones, basically, were the ones that people in general felt the closest to. I think Çarşı especially was a big one. And I think for a lot of people, they kind of met the LGBTI community for the first time. But I don't have data for that because I wanted to look at the subgroup relationships.
I'm curious about the gender.
Yeah.
Because you have already talked to women's rights activists, but like looking at the other groups, for example, how many of them are women, like whether that identity has ever come up?
Sure. So,
and my second question is related to your current research.
Yeah.
Because I think most of the questions that people in the audience are asking now is closely related to your current research that's going on. Because I know from Facebook you are actually looking for people who had no membership before they attended Gezi, but now they are becoming members to a new group. So maybe you can tell us something from the initial
observations. We know that the participation in Gezi was about 50-50 in terms of gender. Unfortunately, our sample is not representative of that because it's quite a snowball. Beyond, I think we have a total of 8 women in our study. So it's one of my biggest, you know, problems. Beyond the women's rights activists, different groups, let's see, Tegebe had women that we spoke to, LGBTI had women that we spoke to, socialists had women that we spoke to. But again, one of the big, so we have 34 people total. Also some of the people from Timog and Taksim Taylish, also who are not mentioned here, are also women. But it's too small a group. Yeah. Dilara had her hand up, right? Yeah. That was the other
Yeah.
So, you know, in our interviews with anti-capitalist Muslims and with our interviews with the LGBTI activists, they both mentioned those particular groups and their relationships with those groups. So one of the LGBTI activists said, you know, it was so sad, we saw these anti-capitalist Muslims sitting on the sidewalk and they didn't even have a tent, and we gave them a tent. We brought them some food, you know, like this kind of mindset. And then they always had a communication between them. And actually, she went on to mention a particular situation where there was only 4 or 5 people left. Like, they had made a chain to prevent the Toma from coming, and there are only 4 or 5 of them left, and 3 are from the LGBTI tent, and 2 are from the anti-capitalist Muslims tent, and they were the ones staying there together. So it may be more specific to her situation, but then also from the anti-capitalist Muslims, we heard very similar things, that they felt close to them because they received and gave help a lot in terms of different situations. So it was one of the things that made me the happiest, you know, when I did the interviews, was to hear those things.
Right,
yeah,
it's just situational, right?
I don't know. I mean, so the people from the anti-capitalist Muslims that we spoke to did not know in person the people that we spoke to from the LGBTI movement. It's not like they knew each other. So the anecdotes that they mention are their specific relationships, yes, but the members in our sample don't know each other. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Okay.
Well,
yeah, go ahead.
Do you think one reason for that can be both LGBT and anti-capitalist Muslims are rather new identities in Turkey? Because, so they are not, you know, they don't have a heavy baggage.
They don't have that established thing of
established animosities. But no, among the others.
I mean, anti-capitalist Muslims was established in 2012.
Yeah.
First time we saw them was in May Day 2012. The LGBTI movement is older, but again, they are not very visible.
Yeah.
So maybe there's something there, I'm not sure.
They are fringe groups.
Go ahead.
Consider any snowball effect in terms of the number increase of the groups. I mean, are we talking about same people in the unit of Gezi and same people in the day act? So, because we are really taking with deep data and in our studies with Twitter data,
mm-hmm.
we find out that there's no snowball effect in terms of numbers. It's the same amount of people who are talking about Gezi in the unit, mm-hmm. as well as they were talking.
Increasing numbers in terms of
specific groups, specific group sizes. Like
group
were,
size, like
yeah.
did the groups grow after Gezi?
Exactly. I mean, did you find any effects there?
I only have anecdotal evidence for that because, say, for example, when I spoke to members of TKP, they said our membership has increased a lot, but we don't have data for that because we don't have we don't keep names. TKP said the same thing. But again, it's only anecdotal because they said we don't keep records because we're not supposed to. So they don't keep records, but a lot of people spoke to them. So I can actually bring that slightly back to Dennis asking to bring up my research now. So I'm focusing now more on, as she mentioned, people who came into Gezi with no political identity. So in the sense that they were not part of an organization and who later joined an organization. Some people actually say that there is a decrease in joining organizations afterwards. Not because they don't want to be active, but rather that they feel they can be active as an individual as well, that Gezi is one of the things that showed them that. But this voice is in the minority of people I have spoke to who have basically been saying, I participated in Gezi, I felt that I had done something right, I felt empowered, and I needed to continue that feeling. I felt the only way I could continue that way is with an organization, which is what I have seen so far. But again, I don't have enough data to mention. So it was yes.
Yeah.
No, go ahead.
Sure.
Mm-hmm.
Same question, actually. Like, I'm going to ask a much more specific version of it,
sure.
Because I'm curious about your questions as well. Are there any questions in your interviews that try to differentiate between Gezi protest creating the Çapulcu identity, protesting itself, versus like remnants of common identity formation from before because of the policies, several policies? And related, this is regarding your answer to my question, which was like facing police brutality is one of the formative experiences of formation of an identity, you said. Then I would say, like again, it's a question about that. Then I would say whether or not that police is symbolizing the force of AKP, the power of AKP and power of the state under AKP's rule.
Yeah.
So it's a symbol of that. That is why it is coalescing people. Or is it because of facing and confronting the violence of the police specifically together that creates the identity? Those two are actually takes my mind to two entirely different places.
Sure.
The first one, the police as the representative of AKP, means that an identity was already in formation.
Yeah.
The second one means that the protest itself, the facing
yes.
violence itself, created
yes.
the identity. And I kind of really would like to know the answer, you know?
Yeah.
Not from you, but in general. Like,
no,
I'm curious about this.
Absolutely.
In your questions, if there are any clues to that, it would be great.
Yes.
Yeah.
Let me tell you. So in the first scenario, this is closer to the experience of existing activists.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? The police are considered representatives of the state. Representatives of the state are working against us, we're working against them.
Mm-hmm.
This is what police brutality is. But for most of the people who participate for the first time in something like this, especially people we call in quotes liberal Democrats,
yeah.
okay, the police are there to protect my values. I'm a representative of the country, I'm a citizen, it's my right to protest, and the police are here to protect me. And then all of a sudden, you see that the police are not protecting you, but are working against you, and then all of a sudden there's a shift, okay? And this is actually, this has been researched before by Drury and Reicher, who work on collective action research. But basically this realization, so imagine that we're all in a protest together, okay? And most of the group is made up of, simple citizens who think that they're doing something good. And of course, there's always those people around the edges who we would call quote-unquote anarchists, who are probably throwing rocks at the police, who are doing this or that, who are very experienced. And as a simple citizen, I'm here, expressing my right. And I don't really know who these guys are throwing rocks, but, I can't really say anything. But the police reacts to them the same way as they react to me. And all of a sudden, there's a shift in my understanding of who I am. So I'm not just someone there and those guys are some other group. We're together because we're being treated the same way. So I would argue that it depends on
the membership or not.
Exactly, yeah. That's what I would say. Remind me the first
one. The first one was very much similar. The protest itself, getting the idea. That was one
yeah.
less level of abstraction, the second question.
Right.
You answered the first one.
Perfect,
yeah.
Cool.
Yeah.
I'm just going to add something. When you think about it, it doesn't have to be one for the other. It was actually kind of.
No. It would be nice to differentiate how it works, because in the mechanisms.
Right, but I think it's actually both mechanisms will work.
Now, you would also say that for the second group, eventually now, they would probably. So those people a year and a half ago who experienced that for the first time are now seeing the police as an arm of the state, the way that the more experienced activists were before. Yeah. I'm sorry, so there's one here, and anyone else? Okay, because I want to, finish with that. That's it.
Mm-hmm. I want to say something about, it's not highlighted, about religious people.
Sure.
And religious part of the issue, I guess. And it has been argued that all the victims, all the loss is leaving Malayan.
Yep. Yeah,
so if you assume that there is a discrimination to those people positioning that they be people in a different category, that is an under category.
Yep.
What do you
danger of underestimating them?
Yeah.
What do you mean by that?
I mean, in Turkey, in a country, if we try to put a group of people drive into something that is already been underestimated.
Yes.
So if they, how can I say, if we see them as people who are not lower class.
Yeah, yeah. Okay.
So what bring out in the society?
I think I got you. Okay, I think I got you. So yes, so the argument has been made that, you know, well, it's not an argument. Everybody who died in Gezi, most of them that we know, the big names that we know,
all
are
internalized.
Yeah, I mean, more people have died, but there are those side effects, heart attacks,
yes,
other things. The people that we know, the eight that we know, were all Alevi, identified in some way as Alevi. This, and also you'll probably remember that a police report came out later, and they said that most of the people that they arrested, 77%, were Alevi. And this was used to distort the perception of the protest as an Alevi protest. Let's keep in mind a couple of things here. Police brutality in Taksim, which is in the public eye, versus police brutality in Sarıgazi, Gazi Mahallesi, Birmayız Mahallesi, Ok Meydanı, is very different. Okay? The police brutality that occurs in Ok Meydanı, which is not in the public eye, is much higher than what happens in Taksim. So what does that mean? It means that people who are protesting there are more likely to be in danger anyway, right? What do we know about all of these neighborhoods? Well, they're working class. They have really high immigrant populations. Immigrant as in they came in the 70s, between the 70s and 90s, from outside of Istanbul. They're disproportionately Alevi and sometimes disproportionately Kurdish. So you have minority neighborhoods who are receiving higher police oppression and, of course, resulting more likely in violence and death. It makes sense. In terms of underestimating the population, this is kind of a big thing. There's, and I have also done some work on the Alevi populations across the country. There's a question of whether the Alevi movement will be the next Kurdish national. More and more, Alevism as an identity rather than as a religion itself is becoming more kind of proponent in the public eye. And at this point, what they need is some sort of organization, some ability to organize, and that could very well be the next kind of movement. As you said, this is a population that is a large minority that has been underestimated for years and who has been oppressed for years. So what we saw in Gezi was not a Alevi protest, per se. What we saw was increased oppression of Alevi people in those neighborhoods and increased arrests, therefore the police report, which reminds us that this is a population that is kind of just needs a, like, flip. Thank you very much.